Okay.
Hello.
Okay. Okay, we can start now. Thank you for coming again to the Lord's place. Sitai. Okay. Then let's stand for congregation to stand for call to worship. Call to worship. Okay. We gather today to worship the one who created us.
The one who called us.
The one who equipped us. With joyous heart, let us worship God. Okay, let us say together an affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and the born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The day he rose again from the dead. He ascended in the heaven and seated at the right of God, the Father Almighty. From then he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life for everlasting. Amen. Okay.
Good morning, everyone. Happy to see everyone. Let's start the day with praising the Lord. I'm glad we get Eileen to be the pianist today.
Yeah.
She hasn't played for a while, but welcome her back. Yeah, let's. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. The second song we are going to sing is Great is Thy Faithfulness. I love this song because it's morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand has provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. And every morning when I sing this song going to work, I always, this is my favorite song in the morning when I go to work, driving to work. And think about the mercy and her faith, God's faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness.
Mm-hmm.
Faithful. Let's sing. Sing hallelujah to Jesus. Our God is worthy to be praised.
Out of every nation, His promise. I am with you evermore. Hallelujah, Heli High Priest, here on earth, our help, our stay.
Please be seated. Let me welcome our TRAC president, Reverend Joshua.
We continue in our posture of worship. We bow in prayer. Oh, bless you, Lord. Father, thank you. Thank you, Lord, for gathering us into your house. Thank you, Lord, for this beautiful day that we, with our children and our grandchildren, here we gather. As generations before us, all who belong to you, here we are on the Lord's Day, here gathered in your presence as a family. Here we bow our hearts in gratitude and thanksgiving as we look back to the week past. So much, O God, you have blessed us. Whether we make our needs known or we have not because of our busyness, and yet as we look back, we see your hand holding us. We realize, oh God, that you are ever watchful over us. Never a moment that we are away from your love, from your care. Thank you, Father. Father, we pray for those who are not well. You have any brothers or sisters, friends, family who are not well, name them before God. For God, hear your prayer, and he answers your prayer. Father, we bring this who are in need. We pray, O God, that you lift them up, sustain them in your strength, in your love, that they know that they're never, ever alone, that your healing hand upon them, your strength, your grace with them now. For those who are seeking affirmation and direction, for our young people, we pray for them, Lord. We bring them before you. We bring these young men and women to you, our young adults who have so much to juggle, to attend to. We pray for a centeredness for them, a shalom, a recentering in their lives. We pray for our children. We pray, O God, that these fertile young minds, these young lives, are properly guided and nurtured, that they grow up well, men and women of integrity and honesty, men and women who love God, who uphold values, your values, who are able to discern the values of the world and pursue goodness, love, compassion, kindness, mercy, all the qualities and attributes that you have called and you have so graciously given to all who are yours. So we pray for our young ones, Lord, that they are raised well in Christ, growing deeper in love, in knowledge, in Christ Jesus. For our church, this is our prayer. Father, we thank you for holding us and keeping us. Thank you, Lord, we are held by the chief shepherd himself, Christ Jesus. We thank you for all our leaders and brothers and sisters as we join hearts and hands together. This is your gift for us this year. That though without a resident pastor to lead us, and yet we find, oh God, new things about ourselves, about our church, a new, deeper relationship we have with one another and with you as we hold hands together, love God together, worship and serve together. We pray that these gifts that you have given us, Lord, continue to grow in depth, in grace, that continue to bear fruit, greater fruit for you and for this church. Thank you for calling us and forming us as Living Hope. This year, the 10th year, almost over now, and next year by February, we shall be celebrating 11 years as the body of Christ. And this is our prayer, that we continue to grow from strength to strength in love, in worship, in service. That this is the light that you have raised up here in Bukit Rimau, in Kota Kemuning, that it shines brilliantly for Christ. This is our prayer. And for our nation, Father, we pray for a nation that is God-fearing. We pray for all those who are given the opportunity to lead the nation in this season and time. We pray godly fear upon them. We pray accountability upon them. We pray that those who are given the opportunity in this season and time in our nation, they lead the country well. This is our prayer for them, for their family. Thank you, Lord. And together we give thanks with the Lord's Prayer. Let us stand and give thanks together with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed Amen. Thank you, Father, for these are the words that Christ himself taught us. We shall teach our children and our children's children. We know it by heart and we live it by heart. In the fullness and the fullness of your word and the prayer be realized in our lives, in our church, in our family. Amen.
Please be seated. Let us say the offertory prayers together. Redeeming Lord, we continually seek your wish. Your deliver us from our unfound fears and provide us with example of your love. In response, we offer this gift. We pray that this fund will provide an outreach that warms people with your love. As a church community, we exalt and praise your holy names. Amen. Church, let us stand for doxology. Be seated. Okay. Greetings to all. Okay. Today, let us welcome Mr. Cooper. It's been a long time, never see you already. whoever don't know, Mr. Cooper is a husband of Winnie's. They both of them staying in Bukit Limau. 4 or 5 years ago, I forgot already, we go to party your place, at your place. Yeah. Okay. Then, let me welcome today our preachers. I believe everyone knows him. our track president, Mr. Reverend Joshua Khong. Then today we have a special announcement. So this announcement very important. So I invite Ms. Ida to come over here to present to us about the activity of December. Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning. Voice is loud enough, huh?
Yes.
Okay. We are moving into the season of Advent in December after Pentecost, and we are going to celebrate the joyous birth of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So, what better way to celebrate the happy occasion than to share our joy with our community? Okay. So. The first thing that we're going to do is, before that, let's remember our vision, growing in Christ, our living hope, our mission, touching lives, bringing hope. So we have lined up the following activities to engage our community here in Gaia Resorts, which we have about 600 shops and condos, and then we are also going to extend this to Duo opposite, which is also about 600, giving us a total of 1,002 apartments and shops to engage in. We bring them a free blood test to our premises on Saturday 7th at 7:30 to 9:30. It is early because you have to fast first. After that, it's actually blood and urine. It's about 61 test results. The minimum that we can cater to is 60 people. And then maximum about 100. But Ian released this Google link about 3 weeks ago, and we have only 4 people signing up so far from Living Hope. Now, please encourage your relatives, your friends, yourselves to sign up. Tomorrow, we are releasing this Google link to Gaia and Geo Resorts so that we engage our community. We have 2 LCC members in the Gaia Management Committee to coordinate this, Ian and actually Dr. Chan. They're in the committee so they can actually tell the management and the residents here. We will need all LHMC people to participate directly in the blood test or indirectly coming to fellowship with the participants, because after their blood test, we'll be eating. So when they're eating, you can sit down, chit-chat with them, fellowship with them, share with them. And then also, we will then request them to fill up a survey form where we will ask them if they will wish to extend their future activities or whether they are interested in other things. The survey form I'll give you later. Okay. Now, one of the activities that we also line up is that the following week, we want to hold reading sessions in English. We want to encourage students to read aloud in English so that they won't be shy to speak in English, especially those who are really from Chinese schools or Chinese educated, and they are good in literacy, but they are very shy, maybe because the parents speak to them Chinese at home. And we also need teachers to volunteer for this work. Lucian, not moving. The following Saturday, we are going to try to get two volunteers to open their house for caroling. It's about 7 to 9:30. The Sunday 15th, we want to have a Thanksgiving lunch after service. Now you ask us, why are we having this Thanksgiving lunch? We're having this Thanksgiving lunch because, as Reverend Joshua has pointed out also, we don't have a pastor this year, but we have a church service every Sunday without fail. We've got speakers coming, we've got a worship team from other churches, we have our own people participating, so we are very thankful for that. The other things that we have to be thankful for is that our leaders step up. You know, we've got Desmond, who became the lay leader instead of Archie, and then we have got Ian putting on many hats, chairman of LCEC, chairman of M&E, social concerns, property management. Somebody's going to relieve him of property management next year, Winnie. So we've got these people who have dedicated their lives here. Now we need everybody to participate all the time. So the Thanksgiving is for that. We have got our administrator who's got the thing going. So it's a Thanksgiving lunch for everybody. And we're going to invite our speakers, past speakers, plus the people from other churches who come and help us. And this Thanksgiving lunch is also going to be open to the community. We are going to tell the community we welcome you, you know, to our church for this Christmas celebration. So make sure that you mark it down in your calendar. Don't miss this. You can't come back again. Right. Now, the following Sunday, we have a sponsored seminary student from East Malaysia coming, Junik. She's in her 30s. Because we don't have much money, but we believe that we should actually encourage people to become pastors. So we have a sponsored seminary student from East Malaysia. And we have a member who has so generously sponsored her transportation, about 788 to KL. She'll be staying with Pastor Alia Baizura of Protestant Church of Sabah, who will be the speaker on that Sunday. After that, they're having a lunch. This is sponsored by our TRAC missions chairman, Francis Chu. Now, it looks like he's only sponsoring for 50 people. If you've got not enough, we'll just buy some more. Okay, now I've talked a lot, but I sincerely hope that this round we all bond together, come together for these December celebrations, okay? It is an important month. It is where we celebrate the birth of our Christ. But then we want to let it be known that we are doing it with joy, and so we're opening out and doing all these activities for the community, for you, every one of you. Amen. Therefore, we ask of each of you to please pray that it's God's will that He has placed you here to serve Him in any capacity, even playing piano, Eileen, and that it's His will for us to celebrate this Christmas season by kickstarting this community service, and that LHMB will shine like a beacon, lighting up Kota Kemuning and Bukit Rimau as we forge ahead in the year 2025 with an assigned pastor in charge. Hallelujah, and all glory to God. Amen. This was posted in the LHMC church group, and after this This is to show you the blood test that they are running, 61 blood tests. And then, this is a link, and then they've got this Google link. Please sign up for it, okay? Now, I have this survey form, it's very tiny here. This is where we need all your help. At the blood test, after the blood test, we need to fill up this survey form. The survey form is to ask them whether they're interested in their children coming for the reading session the following week. And this survey form is also asking them, would you like to join our Christmas lunch on the 15th? Okay, so this form is important that all of us engage ourselves and the people. Okay, sorry I missed all this out. Thanks, Lucian.
Thank you, Aida, for sharing the news.
Jesus, and oh, in Him is mine. Alive in Him, my living hand, and close in righteousness divine. Bold I approach eternal throne and claim.
Let me welcome Master Ethan Lim to come forward for the scripture readings.
Today's scripture text is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 14 to 16. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. This is the word of the Lord.
Today, we are very grateful to able to invite our powerful preacher, our TRAC president, Reverend Joshua Khong, to share his sermons. Thank you.
Thank you, brother. Thank you, Ethan, for very well, right? Good job. My grandson also, Ethan. Today we look at Matthew chapter 5. Now it's a very familiar passage about salt, light. But how does it relate to us here in Living Hope? Matthew 5 recounts Jesus' first public lecture. Let's close our eyes and imagine this first lecture that Jesus gave publicly. And there, as he gathered, as the people are gathered together, waiting with anticipation to hear from Jesus, what do you think that scenario would be like? What would be the thoughts of the people who were listening to him? Perhaps some of them is the first time, but for many, probably it's not the first time either. You see, Jesus is a remarkable young man, and we have a glimpse of that. Remember the time when Jesus was a young boy, well, a teenager, I suppose, or young boy, went with his parents to the temple in Jerusalem. And what happened? As always, the Jewish culture is a very community, very big family kind of thing culture. So they went, the whole kampong went together, and they went to do their obligation, their prayer at the temple. And after they have done that, what did they do? They went back. And they traveled the same way as well as they came the whole kampong, and they went back also the whole kampong. And that explains why they did not realize that Jesus was not in their midst. I guess it was probably quite a long way already. Probably they already reached Klang after Sunday worship. Then only they realized that Jesus is not with them. So what did they do? I think the parents panicked a little bit, didn't they? Where's Jesus? At first, they thought that he was with the auntie or the uncle or with the cousins, because that's the way the Jewish community and culture would be like. Lo and behold, where did they find him? Where was Jesus? Not in Aeon Shopping Mall. He was holding court. He was teaching in the temple. Now, as a young person, he was teaching at the temple, and he knows so much about the Holy Scripture. We can just imagine the years of Christ growing up and the community, the interaction he had with the community, and his reputation as well as someone who is familiar with the Holy Scripture. And that is why here in Matthew chapter 5, now, you see, when you are doing your blood promotion and all this, you have to send flyers, isn't it? You have to send via WhatsApp and all this just to get the people to come. Now, Jesus didn't have that. But, of course, the word of mouth, as people talk about him, and as I think he also made known that he's going to give a public lecture, a preaching, because it was not a spontaneous thing that there were only a handful there, but it was a sermon on the mount as it is known to us. He prepared for this. As he prepares for this, why did he choose to talk about a city that is built atop a hill? Why did he choose to talk about you are the light? Now, let's go back to this then. Jesus, in his first public lecture, and this is one of the times that he actually revealed about his divine nature, who he is, or his divine role that is appointed to him, which is very important because it is the first time that Jesus come into the public spectacle, and there he launched himself into public ministry now. He came to talk about two things, about the vision of who they are as God's people and their mission as God's people. That's why I also titled for our reflection this morning, Never Lose Sight of Our Vision and Our Mission. The people came, especially those who had heard about him and also who have heard him teaching before themselves. They were the first layer of people who probably were at the front seat, gathered there, so happy to be there. And then they also shared with others, encouraging others to come to listen to this man who will have great things to share with them. Basically, I think those who were gathered there, they were not just cold calls, like people who doesn't know anything, but these are people who at least have a heart. They desire to hear from Yahweh. They are primarily, you can imagine, they are Jewish people who were gathered at the Sermon on the Mount. And many of them were just normal Jews, fishermen, farmers, people who long to hear God's voice, because up until this time, God had been very silent. The last prophet that he spoke through was Malachi. After Malachi, there was a long silence. And do you know how long is the silence? Ethan, you know? 400 years. Now, 400 years is a very long time that God did not send anyone to be his prophet or to speak on his behalf. And this silence was only broken when John the Baptist began to preach about the kingdom of God and preaching about someone who is coming very, very soon and whose sandal I'm unfit to tie. So when this someone now begin to speak, you can just imagine the anticipation as those who were longing to hear from God, those who were godly, and those who were the remnants of Israel, they came. So now we understand why Jesus chose these two. Never lose sight of their vision, because in this 400 years of silence, it was like darkness, isn't it? Because they're so used to hearing God guiding them and pointing them. So it's like darkness for them. But Jesus said, never lose your vision. But in fact, he gave them a very glorious picture. Instead of losing their vision, they are the one who will be lifted up and projecting light that others will have vision. Isn't that amazing? That was his first public lecture. And Jesus, that is why we can understand why he's such a great, great teacher and speaker. And then he talked about their mission and what God shall be doing and God is doing in them. I think for us here in Living Hope, it resonates with you, especially this year. You were not given a pastor because suddenly your pastor decided to resign. Because you can't just manufacture from the supermarket and get a new loaf, isn't it? So without a pastor, but you stood in because you love God. You are like those who were gathered that morning at the mount where Jesus preached. Because you love God, you have that desire, you have that hunger. You long to hear his voice. And God never failed those who love him. Amen? And even though you, as you look back, you do not have a pastor to give you pastoral care, but you were not lacking. That God continued to hold you, not only sustaining you and sending you forth to serve, but also God keeps you in his bosom, that you hear his heartbeat, that you hear his voice, because you can't lead others when you yourself not nurtured, not being sustained in this way. So I can see God doing that for you and raise you up to be strong, mighty, growing, maturing leaders, because God kept your vision for you. And you never lose your mission as well. So I'm so glad you actually have both left and right. Your vision is that you want to grow in Christ, and then what is your mission? To touch lives. And you have not lost track of that, because as I hear Ida sharing about what you're going to do in December, you are on on the dot, spot on with what you know God is doing and is doing in your midst. Praise the Lord, amen? Amen. Yes, we have so much to be thankful for indeed, and I'm glad you all are doing this. Thankful Thanksgiving lunch and service and celebration. Now let's go to Jesus, why it captivates the people, Matthew chapter 5. Jesus painted a picture for them that they are going to be lifted up to be a city atop a hill. But before that, he went to this very important verse. And what is this verse? These are the words that Jesus said to them. And let's read this together as what Jesus had told them. 1, 2, 3. You are salt of the earth. But if the earth loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out, trampled upon by men. Now, as we read this word aloud, as we hear it, it didn't wrench our heart with pain, does it? But for the Jews, especially the godly Jews who were gathered there, their heart was struck painfully. Now, you know why? Jesus is not talking about table salt here. When the table salt expired, then you can't use it for anything. He's not talking about that. Because he was telling them the consequence that if you are good for nothing already, for what you were raised up to do, then you will be trampled upon by men. The Jews understood this because the Bible in the Old Testament talk about the salt covenant. The salt covenant is God's covenant with the Jewish people, which is an everlasting covenant. They're raised up with this everlasting covenant to be a people who will point other tribes and nations to the worship of the true and living God. So here Jesus, the voice that pierced the darkness, after 400 years of silence, he reminded them again. And I'm sure he was so happy to see that the godly who came to listen to him that morning, these are the ones who are the remnants of Israel, still hungry and thirsting for Yahweh's word. So he began here, you are the salt of the earth. Talking about the Jewish nation, the Jewish people who are the salt of the earth, the salt covenant that God covenanted with them, an everlasting covenant. And Jesus said, never lose that. Because if you lose that, what the purpose that you were called to, then man will trample upon you. I think for those who were there and their heart were hit very painful, suddenly, I can even see some may have tears in their eyes as they realize this. And suddenly they recognize that truly this is the Messiah who is going to lead us. Because Jesus, before he came to verse 13, we know that we had the Beatitudes. Jesus began the sermon with the Beatitudes, where he talked about the qualities, the attributes, the things, the characteristics of those who will be God's children, who would be his disciples. And you are very familiar with what he talked about in the Beatitudes. So after he had reminded them of who they are and the covenant that God had with them, they have this sole purpose of pointing others unto Christ. Then he launched into that you are the light of the world. Indeed, these special people that God covenanted with, the salt of the earth, they shall be lifted up and be built like a city atop a hill. This is another thing that Jesus captivates the people who were there. Why? Because as they were listening, they were also imagining. You see, they don't have PowerPoint like us. They can. All these are provided. People of their time, their imagination actually is very powerful and very rich because as people are teaching, because they're also having that kind of vision that they can see with their mind as they hear Christ preaching to them. Jesus is saying that he is going to do something mighty, something glorious, and something impossible. Mighty, glorious, and impossible. Mighty. Why? As you talk about an edifice being raised up atop a hill, the first vision that you will have of edifices up a hill atop a high place normally is a fort. Correct or not? To raise up a fort. Why? To look out for enemies to come. But Jesus is not building a fort because he is the Prince of Peace. He's raising up a city which symbolizes life, sustenance of life. He's raising up a city atop a hill, not a fortress atop a hill. He's raising up sustenance and giving life. It captures the people's imagination what this promised Messiah comes to do. Now, no city, it is mighty, I said. It is glorious. Why? He said it will shine its light that it cannot be hidden. That is how glorious this city is. And then thirdly, he's doing something impossible. To those who were fishermen and farmers, who were very familiar with their habitation, their township, to imagine that there will be a town atop a hill, they can just imagine the grandeur as well as the impossibility to raise up a city atop a hill, even for today as well. Now, where do you find cities? Normally, where do you find cities? Where is Kuala Lumpur? It's by the Muara. Where is Shanghai? Where is London? Where is New York? Where do you find all the big cities? Normally at the lower ground, lower plains, by the Muara Sungai, by the rivers, by the waterways, because this is where all the natural resources would be in abundance, and where the sustenance of a growing population is a natural one, because it can be sustained by the natural resources in the lower plains. But up in the city, above a hill, in the mountain, not easy. That Christ is doing the impossible. That Jesus giving them hope, you see. They were silent for 400 years. And for the first time when he preached publicly, he preached hope as well. And what is the name of our church? Yes. It resounds for you as well. And that's why you chose this word, that there will always be hope. Amen? That's right. So Jesus gave them this beautiful vision. We think that the Sermon on the Mount ended with chapter 5, isn't it? How many of you think that it ended with chapter 5? You got to repent because it did not end with chapter 5. In fact, it was a very long public lecture, which makes sense. When you're given a chance to do something, you want to do it well. You want to do it in fullness. You want to do it perfectly. So Jesus did that as well. He didn't just stop at chapter 5, because then if you stop at chapter 5, then you'll see that you lose the mind, the impact of what you want to do. In fact, Jesus continued his teaching. This public lecture went on and on and on from chapter 5 to chapter 6, all until chapter 7. It ends in chapter 7. He began in chapter 5. Of course, we know the Beatitudes. That's why we thought it was only in chapter 5. The Beatitudes is talking about the characteristics, the attributes of Jesus' followers. Who are Jesus' followers? We are his followers. Then, of course, was his first premiere, first speech. And so he went into details, detailing for them, this is their personality that will be seen by others. This is the characteristic of those who are his disciples that will be seen by others. It is in the next slide that will remind you what are the characteristics there. That for those who are poor in spirit, next slide. For those who mourn, for those who are meek, for those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for those who are merciful and pure in heart, for peacemakers, for those who are persecuted for righteousness. When Jesus talked about the kingdom of God and what he comes to do, he gave them a full picture. He's not selling them on the good points, but selling them the fullness of what would come in all its fullness, in the kingdom of God, in the people of God. So these are the people of God These are his followers, his disciples. Those who are poor in spirit, who know that they shall be filled with the Holy Spirit. They shall be continue to grow in spirituality. Because if we think that we are full, things that are full, we cannot pour in anymore, isn't it? Because it's already full. But because we are poor, we're still needing to be infilled. And blessed are those who are mourning, because in the early church, there were a lot of mourning because there were great persecution. But for those who are mourned, they will be comforted as they remember back what Jesus spoke to them. Then they were so encouraged that they heard it themselves from the mouth of Christ himself. Those who are mourned will be comforted. Those who are meek, actually, they are the strong ones. Those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, these are the blessed ones. Those who are merciful, even when you are persecuted, you don't retaliate with violence. And that was one of the things that propelled the church that continued to grow and grow and grow. And pure in heart, and who are peacemakers, and who are persecuted by righteousness. So Jesus continued on with that. After he had finished that, then we know he launched into the reminder of their identity, that they are a covenant people with God, with this everlasting covenant of salt covenant, that they shall not be trampled upon by man, because they shall live up to the covenant. So who are the one who will fulfill the covenant? Jesus will fulfill the covenant with his disciples. Amen? And that's why we are here. That's why you're doing what you're doing. You are growing in Christ and you are touching lives. You got it right here. Well done. So these are the people who are bind in oneness throughout the generations in the salt covenant and everlasting covenant. And then as Jesus continued to share about what he is going to do, what he is about to do. You see, when you talk about the light, the city that is built atop a hill, he showed them the glorious, the magnificent city. And also then he went to the micro description of it. He said, when you light a lamp, a light, you don't hide it under a bowl or a basket, but you put it on its lampstand. And then you also see, he said, so that it will give light to all in the house. Did you notice why he used the house? He was speaking to the Jewish people, and they understood, primarily the Jews understood what Jesus was saying, that those who were faithful, the faithful remnant of Israel, God has come in his time now, and you will be lifted up. You are like the candle that is going to be lit up, the light that will be on the candlestand. The Jews truly understand this, because it talks about images of the altar where the candle is lit up and put on the candlestand. That they know that Christ is calling them to a life of purpose. They were so, so captivated now. And as Jesus captivated their attention and their heart, he began to launch into the main body of his public lecture. So the main body of this public lecture is talking about these holy people, these who were described in the Beatitudes with the eight characteristics there. These are the righteous who hunger for righteousness, who are persecuted for righteousness. So he began to teach about righteousness. Those who belong to the righteous and holy God, the righteous and holy people. So he launched into that. So you, as any good Methodist, had a 3-point sermon. So you had the first point, righteousness that relates to the Torah, the second point, righteousness that relates to their religious practices, and the third one, righteousness that relates to right relationship. Jesus is a good Methodist. Or is there the other way around? We follow Jesus. We do in 3 points.
Who were the religious leaders then? Pharisees and the Sadducees, right? And Jesus oftentimes rebuked the Pharisees and the Sadducees because they were just showing empty religion. Do you know Jesus? We have this in the gospel as well. Jesus said, when you pray with such eloquence, such beautiful language, even Shakespeare also had to learn from you. You are lifted up to the heavenlies until you cannot come down from the heaven. You have no earthly good. And that was the failures of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Their religion was a show of a grandeur of demonstration, but hollow and empty within. And we also see in the gospel, Jesus said, look at your religion. The Ten Commandments is that God said to love, the first one to relate to your relationship with one another is to love, honor your parents. But in the religious time of Jesus' time and he was ministering among them, what was his charge? That you fail to care for your elderly, fail to care for your parents. And then they gave the excuse. What was the excuse? That we have given all our donation and our money to the temple. We have no more to care for our elderly. So Jesus came to correct that. That was the middle part of his teaching, the public lecture there. And many of them now begin to reflect. That conversation, I believe, was an ongoing conversation in their mind and heart. So they begin to identify the things that were not right in their religious practice, in their time. A brilliant teacher indeed Jesus is. And then he wraps it up with this. The third part is righteousness that relates to right relationship. Righteousness that relates to right relationship, I purposely use a singular here, relationship. I'm not saying relationships, even though it points to our relationship with God and with others. When you come to teach this part about our, in the next slide, brother, come to teach about this part about our right relationship, our righteousness that relates to relationship, one key thing that you highlighted at the forefront of this teaching is treasures. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in. He did that, and then this is the last part already, and then he ends the righteousness that relates to right relationship in chapter 7, in verse 12. So in everything you do to others, what you would do to them, do that. And that sums up the law and the prophets. We know that he had taught the whole thing already. He started with the law and the prophets, and now he wrapped it up. Is the ending of the main body of his teaching. Let's look at why Jesus talked about treasures when it relates to a right relationship with God and with others. I bring you back to the Gospel of Matthew as well. Matthew, probably this writer Matthew who wrote the Gospel, he still remember from the Sermon at the Mount. And later on, in Matthew chapter 19, when he witnessed for himself what Jesus said, I tell you, he must have been a light that shine in here and here. As he recorded the event that happened. Because in Matthew chapter 19, what happened? There was this very pious, godly, Jewish young man. This young man, a wealthy young man, very pious means very religious young man. He fulfills all that is required as a Jewish person. He was so proud of himself, and his community too were proud of him, because he publicly came to Jesus and he stated aloud what he had accomplished as a godly Jewish man. And he might be, it's not about arrogance. If you read the Matthew 19, it's not arrogance at all. He had a genuine hunger to grow more, actually. To be more. So he asked Jesus, is there anything else that I need to do? He asked that. And what did Jesus say to him? Leave all this behind. Come and what Jesus taught here is so true, because I'm going to talk about the aspect of the right relationship, where the treasure here can be either a blessing or an obstacle. This year is 139 years of the Methodist Church upon this land. Next year we have a big celebration, and I began the celebration this year already. I engaged all the track churches that we do Project 140. Now, I always believe that when we do celebration, especially birthday celebration, it should not be just a one-off thing. How many of you celebrate your birthday more than just one event? You celebrate like for one whole week or one whole month, some of you. Yeah. I can see some of you laughing because you can identify whether you celebrate your birthday one whole month, isn't it? So we're going to celebrate the birth of the Methodist Church, not just the one event next year, but I started last this year. So with the young people, young adults, I want them to go deep into their church, because what was the first sermon about the Methodist Church? Not by might nor by strength, but by my spirit. I want them to delve deeper into the church and see the Spirit of God moving in the local church, how God planted the church. Because in the Methodist Church, we cannot just plant church by human effort on the internet. All those who planted churches, you know. The conference, the district conference, the annual conference decision. Why so many decisions? Because when we come collectively to wait on God, come collectively to understand and to know that this is from God, that He is birthing this church. Just like any birth. As a mom carries a child for 14 months and birthed the child. This is the process. So our planting churches as well is not human effort. So I wanted to delve into that, how God moved mightily and planted so many churches in Malaysia, Methodist Church. Not only in our conference, but of course particularly I'm leading my conference, so I do this project for our conference. I invited every local church to participate in that. It's a Project 140 where you go and ask the leaders, the people you investigate, people you delve deeper into your church at its journey, and recognize not by might, nor by strength, nor by power, but by my spirit. And I'm so glad to report to you that our young people did well, many of them did well, and they submitted the project. Because when they do this project, they will benefit two things. They will learn love, because when you go and delve deeper into the church, you begin to know more about your church. When you know more about your church, you can love your church deeper, isn't it? Yes. That's why those who are finding here, you love the church very much. And even though no pastor here, you still love the church. Because it is part of it, isn't it? You love the church, because when you can really love something that you know it by heart. So I want the young people, because some of our churches are very, very old already. They will feel so distant. Some of our churches are more than 100 years old. So I want them to go to this and then know their church. When we know the church, we love our church. When we love our church, we become loyal to our church. Amen? So these are the two benefits from Project 140 that I need. So this year, next year is 140 years. The testimony of men and women was captivated by Matthew 5, who gave up their lives, their career, their success to come to British Malaya then. They were, unlike the young man in Matthew 19, they can leave all this behind. Mind you, those who came 140 years ago to plant the church called the Methodist Church in Malaysia and Methodist Church Singapore, they gave up a lot. They gave up a lot. They actually were the cream of the society as well. If you read up the history of the Methodist Church and how it was planted, those people who came here, they are not people who cannot find work in their own country, that's why they came here, you know. These are engineers and lawyers and learned people who came here and get themselves, because they caught the vision of the Word of God. That God is building a city atop a hill. They have caught the impossible, and they want to do the impossible together with God and journey with God for this impossible. 140 years ago, come to British Malaya is no small commitment. You know, you can't like go to the net and Google and see what is British Malaya like. No, you can't. You will only find out British Malaya what it is like when you step foot on British Malaya after sailing 4 months, 6 months, sailing 2 months from America, from Australia, from India. After you have sailed all these months, you come, then only you know what it is like. And then you are welcomed by the army of mosquitoes. And many actually died here because they cannot survive the tropical disease as well. But they were willing to give up all their treasures to pursue treasure in heaven. So this is what Jesus was teaching as he closes up about the right relationship with God and with people, and that our treasure holds us back. After
after I've done all that, lecture, of course, must have application, isn't it? Because any good sermon must have an application of how I'm going to apply what we have learned. So Jesus here launched into the application. And what is the application here? He's asking them for commitment. And his commitment made it simple. Either you will choose convenience, just continue to live your life as is, or you choose commitment and you face the challenges. Brothers, can you move the next slide for me, please?
And what did Jesus say? Let's read this together. 1, 2. Amen. This also wraps up Jesus reminding them that you are the salt of the earth. If you fail to live up to the purpose that you were raised up, man will trample upon you. And here he used a very strong word as well, that he said, the road that is broad and wide leads to destruction. People will trample upon you. Many will go through it. But those who are faithful, those who desire God, and ones who follow me, you will find your way to the narrow gate. Jesus is a brilliant teacher of faith. I think this, we have to learn this as well. You see, we are so raised up in Western worldview that it has to be politically correct, that we don't even want to impose or invade the privacy of our children and grandchildren, that we give them a lot of objective choices, let them choose. And then when they have made up their mind, that's it, that's good, because they are given that choice, they choose it for themselves. You see, Jesus actually did a very long lecture here, and then when he come to the application part, he didn't give you objective A, B, C, or D to choose from. He give you two actually. But even then, he narrowed it down. You see how with five words, with authority of blessing, he instructed them. What were the five words? Enter through the narrow gate. Very authoritative. He guided them. As Christian grandpa, grandma, as Christian parents, we learn from Jesus. Don't go and wait for the children, give them A, B, C, D, and then sometimes give so generous, give them A, B, C, D until E some more, and then let them choose. And many will choose the easy way, isn't it? Jesus said that. That's our human nature. But few will find it. Why did he use the word find? When we find something, we need to be guided. We need to be led. That's why I use the word find. You see how what a brilliant teacher he is. Every word that he chose is crafted beautifully, purposefully. Few will find it. So we need to help them to find it. Amen? Okay, I'll go to the last slide now, even though I got a bit more, because today is Holy Communion. Sometimes too. Yeah. Okay, correct, this one, okay. The other one, you read for yourself, I give it to your leaders already. I skip one slide, I go to this slide then. Okay, Jesus, as he concluded in his teaching, the application, here also he prepares them. I want to tell you the whole, give you the full picture there. He also talked about the two trees. The two trees can symbolize two things. The first one is that he said, You be prepared for false prophets, false teachers who will come. He said you will know the fruit, the tree by its fruit, because he is actually teaching them about the kingdom of God that is about to come. So he had to warn them about the bad trees, about the false prophets and false teachers. But we also don't want to end up being bad trees as well, because we have to be good trees that bear good fruit. Amen? If we enter through the narrow gate, we will be the good tree. As we listen to the good prophets anointed and sent by God, we will continue to grow. And that is what his teaching is here, that we will be the good tree as we hearken our ears to the right teaching. So we must make the effort to continue to grow in the word, in the knowledge of God. And then he said, you build your house either on sand or on rock, the solid rock. Here again, he's also guiding us and giving specific instruction, because if you build on sand, what will happen? It is not stable. When calamity comes, it will be swallowed up. But when you build on rock, no matter how difficult things are, you will stand strong. Come, let us pray. Oh, bless you, Lord. Father, we thank you for your word for us. We thank you for speaking to us so powerfully. Father, we pray that as we continue to love and serve here in Living Hope, we never forget what you have given us and spoken to us, our vision, growing in Christ, our mission, touching lives for Christ. I want to thank you for my brothers and sisters here in their faithfulness. Oh Lord, in their faithfulness, they arise powerfully for this. Because you sustain them and lift them up. Because you are the one building a city atop a hill. You are the one building, and you are the one creating, making good what is impossible. And you put them like a candle on its proper stand, that they shine their light brilliantly to those around them. Now we prepare our hearts to come to the table to receive communion. And this is our prayer, that we and our children and our children's children be guided, be blessed. The Lord, that we together with our children and children's children be bearers of good news. Even for our children, we want to engage them to be bearers of good news, to bring the good news of Christ to their little friends, to their teachers, to the community, that together none of us are left behind, but everyone have a role in what you're doing in our midst, in our church, here in Living Hope. We thank you, we praise you, Lord. Oh, we love you, Lord. Thank you for loving us. Oh, thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's sing the song of communion, Break Thou the Bread of Life.
Please be seated. Christ our Lord Jesus invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. And therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you. Amen. We continue in the posture of prayer as we come in personal confession and repentance before God. God of mercy, compassion, and love, we come before you as your son and daughter. We confess of the things that does not belong to you. We know there's nothing that we can hide from you, so we confess and we repent. For as we confess and repent with contrite, broken hearts, you remove the things that does not belong to you. You pluck it out. You throw it far, far away. For you say, as far as the east is from the west, never to meet again. And in its place, you plant gift of grace that we continue to grow in the perfect love in Jesus Christ. So brothers and sisters, as the Holy Spirit search and know you, hold back not, but surrender in confession and repentance. Amen. Thank you, Father, for wiping away our tears, our shame, our guilt. Thank you, Lord, for forgiving, for restoring. As you forgive, you restore us and you lift us up and clothe us in Christ's righteousness. That we stand before you, your beloved son, daughter. Oh, we love you, Lord. We love you, Father. Brothers and sisters, in Christ, you are forgiven. Hear the good news that Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. We share the sign of peace and reconciliation with one another. How do we do it here in Living Hope? Okay. Do what you... The peace of God be with you. Amen. Let us stand. We rise together for the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and you breathed upon into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, saying, holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and spirit. Please be seated. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples and Jesus said, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Now do this in remembrance of me. When supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you and gave it to his disciples and Jesus said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Now do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of this, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy, living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. We proclaim the mystery of faith. Father, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body, the blood of Christ, that we be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, with your Holy Spirit in your Holy Church, all honor and glory yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. The table in the Methodist Church is open to all who have received Christ as personal Savior and Lord, and in public declaration in baptism declared their faith. Please come to the table as Christ invites us. We shall all receive the cup and the wafer, and when all have received, we break bread together in the symbol of one. One bread, one body, one life to live in Christ. You can invite the little children to come and we say prayer of blessings for them. All the little children come to the front, to the altar here. Please come, children. Come and receive blessings from the Lord. 来，我们一起来。 来这边，啊，可以了，嗯，好。I pray for the little ones. Come, I pray for the little ones first. Father, we thank you for come, Ethan. That's right. Father, we thank you for all these little ones. These are precious little children that you know them by name. We bring them before you for your blessings, your anointing to be upon them, that they grow up well in Christ, grow up well as godly young men and women in their own generation. We pray for your blessings for them as you bless them in your favor and your grace. May they be raised up well. May they be raised up as men and women set apart holy unto you, and their lives overflow with blessing from you. Praying for them that they'll be good students in the schools and play school, and also they'll be good children and grandchildren for their parents and their grandparents. Praying that the legacy of a living faith being passed on from one generation, and these precious ones, as Jesus said, let them come to me. So we bring them to you to receive your blessing, O Lord. Bless them and keep them, that they grow mature in beauty and grace in Jesus Christ. Amen. And now for the adults, we are going to break bread. We lift up the bread. One bread, one body, one life to live in Christ only. Amen. Let's break bread together, the symbol of one. We lift up the cup, and with grateful hearts, we drink in one accord together now. Amen. Bless you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for feeding us. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. We know a great price was paid that we can stand before you as sons and daughters. So, Lord, send us forth, we who break bread together. The one life to live for Christ, we live well, holding each other's hands, co-laboring together as your co-workers, that we continue to grow in Christ and touch lives for Christ. So, brothers and sisters, go forth now in the anointing and blessing of God the Father. Go forth now as He rests His Spirit upon you and send you forth in His Spirit. Go forth with courage and boldness and in obedience, in faithfulness. Go forth to love, to worship, to serve. That Christ be magnified, be glorified in you. That you, the city, atop a hill to shine brilliantly for Him. Go forth and walk humbly in Him until Christ comes back for us in victory. Amen. God bless you.
Let's rise and sing the closing hymn together, Higher Ground. I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lead me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plan than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these are bound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plan than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan's dart at me are hurled. For faith has called a joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plan than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the almost high and catch a glimpse of glory bright. But still I pray till helps I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lead me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land. A higher plan than I have found.
Thank you, Lord, for raising us up and building us a city atop a hill. May we shine brilliantly for you, Lord, here in Bukit Rimau, in Kota Kemuning and beyond. May families, may individuals, may men, women be pointed unto you. May you lift us up as vessels, a candle on its stand. May our lives be employed fully for you, Lord. This is our prayer. And receive ye the benediction, brothers and sisters. May the love of God our Father, who called us each by name, inscribed it in the book of life, the grace of Christ, our Savior, Redeemer, King, the blessings, counsel, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, now be with you and go with you now and always. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
God bless you. Isn't it good to be in God's house? Amen. Amen.